Yeah, welcome back to our lecture, Applied Mathematical Finance. So we just completed a section where we introduced a few financial products that are options, different options on interest rates, caplet, swaption. So I already made the remark, yeah. So now we have nonlinear products. So now we require a model to value these financial products. A first step is to use a model that is simple enough such that we can derive an analytic formula. Well, such models are sometimes perceived as being too simple, but they serve very special, very important functions because sometimes prices on the market are not quoted in terms of a currency. For example, this option costs you that amount of euro or whatever. They are quoted in terms of a model parameter. So what is the parameter value that you have to plug in to a model in order to get the value of the option? That sounds a little bit strange. Yeah. So why is that? The reason is that the value of the financial product depends on many different quantities. It depends on the current interest rate, so the expectation, but then it also depends on some stochastic properties. So what is the variance, yeah, or the standard deviation or whatever, the distribution the market is expecting from this option? And to decouple these effects a little bit, one likes to quote or mention a parameter that doesn't change so quickly if properties change on the market. So maybe we can comment on this later. So also, if these analytic models that we will discuss look so simple, they are sometimes important to say, express the value or the price of an option in terms of model parameter. Before we start with this section, yeah. So for example, we had introduced the caplet, which is just a call option on the interest rate. It's maybe nice to repeat again the Black-Scholes model for a stock, because what you see here looks exactly similar. So if you replace here this guy here with some, say, value S of T1, then this looks a little bit like having a call option on the stock, maximum of S minus K and zero. Well, the only thing is that in Black-Scholes model for the stock, that is paid immediately in T1. Here it is paid in T2. So, but paying it later in the Black-Scholes model would actually not make a difference. So there is a relation between the Black-Scholes formula for the stock and the Black formula or Black-Scholes formula then for the caplet. And to understand this relation, let me shortly review the Black-Scholes model for a stock. So just that you don't get confused. Now in this section, interest rates are no longer stochastic. We have the very simple Black-Scholes model where the interest rate is described by a single parameter R. Okay, so let's start with a repetition of maybe how you find it in textbook. And then let's generalize this a little bit such that we can use this formula for stochastic interest rates. Okay, so we assume now that interest rates are deterministic. So don't be confused. We are now looking at stocks. Interest rates are deterministic. So there is an interest rate R of T. So it can depend on time. Yeah, so here, and this describes our bank account. So we have here the bank account our risk-free financial product, which is actually given here by this ordinary differential equation. DB is RB dt. So you can immediately integrate this. So dB by dt is RB. So you see this is just the exponential function. We assume that we have initial value 1 in our bank account. So I have that the B is 1 unit of currency times exponential integral R of tau d tau. Okay, R is measured in units per time. You multiply with the time. This is a unitless object. This is a unitless object. You multiply with one currency. Everything looks quite good. So then the Black-Scholes model assumes a log normal dynamic for the stock. So then the Black-Scholes model here assumes a log normal dynamic for the stock. So we have this E2 process here for the stock value S. S of t is the value of the stock that we observe under the real probability measure P. So here we are under the real probability measure P, the objective measure. So therefore here I have a parameter mu superscript p. I assume that the volatility parameter, which is here, is larger than 0. So that's maybe needed to do Gesanov theorem. Okay, so that's the setup. So that's our model. So maybe here I write that this is our model for the financial market. The product which we would like to value, so that here is the financial product, is just the option on this stock. So here I have the value of S observed at capital T. So here capital T is the exercise date of the option. Okay, and I also have capital T as payment date. So that amount is paid in capital T. So what are now the steps to calculate the value? So what I like to do is I would like to calculate the value of this financial product in time zero. So let's assume little t equal to zero is now. So what are now the steps to solve this problem? So the first step is that we know from our universal pricing theorem that we can move to an equivalent Martingale measure, well, under certain assumption. So I have some equivalent Martingale measure where under this measure, all the traded assets divided by the numerator, so all numerator relative value processes are martingales. Okay, so if this is the case, then this value process of our financial derivative is also a martingale, and we can use the martingale property to value this financial product. Yeah, so this here is from the martingale property. So the first step is that I choose a numerator and I derive the model now under this new numerator. So we have our numerator and then we need to derive the model under the new numerator. So this means I need to derive the model under the measure Qn. Well, I know that under the measure Qn, all numerator relative value process are martingales. And the two tools that we use here are Gersanov and Ito, because there's a nice little thing. Okay, so maybe here as a small comment. So what is the comment? Question, how do you find this probability measure? So how do I find here the probability measure Qn? So the reason is that we do not need to move to a new to the probability measure in the sense that we need to determine the probabilities. We do not need to find the probability measure. We can use Kirsanov theorem that tells me that a change of measure is actually like, yeah, or can be seen as a change of the drift of the stochastic process. Yeah, okay, so you have here the drift of the stochastic process. So the drift is this stuff here in front of the DT. So if you apply a change here to the measure, that will induce a change in the DT. Yeah, so we have the DWP is equal to a DWQ plus minus some gamma DT. So we can use this very nice, very powerful theorem that a change of measure is actually like a change of drift. And the second thing is that we can have a look at the martingales using Itô's lemma. So we can write down the stochastic processes of all those martingales using Itô's lemma. And then we have the property that a martingale, so being a martingale under Qn, so let me just write Qn martingale here, is like drift is zero. So instead of finding the measure, I just find under which condition is the drift of these zero. So how do I have to choose my parameters to make the drift zero? So once we have solved this second step, then I know the stochastic differential equation under Qn. And from that, I can derive the probability distribution of S and N under this Qn. So this means I know the probability distribution of the guy that is here inside the expectation, yeah? Because this guy is a function of S and N, and now I know the probability distribution. So I have to take the expectation of something of which I know the probability distribution, and maybe I can do this analytically. And then if I have done this, I have the value, okay? So these are the steps that you perform. Let me go through this quickly. So first step, we choose a numerator. Actually here, if you look at this problem with the Black-Scholes model, you do not see this magic or the power that lies in this choice of numerator. But we will see this later, for example, for the quantum caplet, which is a very nice example, that there are different choices of numerator that we can use, and some make the things easier. Yeah. So also later, if you look at, for example, big interest rates model, like the LIBOR market model, the change of numerator changes numerical properties. If a numerical method is stable or has a high numerical error, becomes unstable, the change of numerator has a big impact. Here in this setup, actually, this is not seen. Also because the choice of the numerator is so natural. Yeah, so what we choose is, we choose here our bank account as the numerator. And the thing is that the numerator is now deterministic. You know, the bank account is just this e to the rt, or e to the integral rt tau d tau. So it can be moved out of the expectation. So we choose this guy as a numerator, and now we have the second step. So the second step was change of numerator, change of measure. So what is here the probability measure? So we know that the Itô process under this new measure just has a different drift. So now I write here mu qn, and the question is, what is mu qn? So the point is, we can derive this drift from the martingale property. So I know that this thing here is a martingale. So this means if I write down the stochastic process of this thing, the stuff that is in front of the dt has to be zero. Okay, so this guy here will imply that this part will be zero. But before I arrive there, I have to do some calculation. And the calculation is actually Itô's lemma. So ds divided by b, so the differential of s divided by b is actually Itô's lemma. Here, Itô's lemma is a little bit disguised as the product rule or the quotient rule. So the differential of, say, x divided by y. So what's that? So this is 1 divided by y times dx. So, but you can write this a little bit nicer. So this is dx divided by x multiplied with x divided by y. So actually this is the same as dx multiplied with 1 divided by y. So then plus, actually now with a minus, because I'm differentiating the 1 divided by y. So now with a minus, minus actually now x divided by y squared dy, but then I can write this as x divided by y dy divided by y, okay? So these are the classical calculus first order terms, but then you know from Itô's lemma, we also have a second order term, and here we have the two second order term, dx divided by x times dy divided by dy, and dy divided by y squared. So these are the two second order terms, yeah, you also have in Itô's lemma. Okay, so maybe you can check this or look it up. Yeah, it's, or maybe it's a separate rule for dx divided by y for Itô processes. So if we have this, so we have here the first guy is the s divided by b that is in front. And then we have dx divided by x. Well, my x is ds. So my process of s is here. If I divide this by s, this guy goes away, this guy goes away. So I have mu dt plus sigma dw. So this is just the first part here. This is mu dt sigma dw. Then I have dy divided by y, which is just the b the dB divided by b. So this is just dr dt. So this guy here is just dr dt, and also in front, the s divided by b. Okay, so this will appear here in front of all these guys. So let me just mark it all in the same color. Okay, so and the next guy is now the second order term. So we have a second order term. This here, this is the dx divided by x, dy divided by y. So I have a product here. It is the ds divided by s and the dy divided by y. This is a y, okay. And the last one is this guy here, the dy divided by y squared, which is just r dt squared. And you know, dt is zero. So actually this guy here vanishes, dt is zero. This here vanishes. dt is zero, dw is zero, so this will also vanish. And you see that we have here a dt part left over, and here we have the dw part left over. So we get this expression. So you see that the drift in front is mu minus r dt plus sigma dw, everything is multiplied with s divided by b. Martingale property tells me that mu has to be equal to r. So the drift under my risk neutral measure, my equivalent martingale measure is this R. So now I know the stochastic process under the new measure. So I know that this stochastic process looks like that with parameter mu being equal to R. And then the next step is to derive the distribution of S under this measure. So, and to ease this a little bit, S is a log normal process. So it's much nicer to write down the stochastic process for the logarithm. So that's another application of Itô's lemma. So we write down the stochastic process for the logarithm. So then the coefficient S in front of the dt and dt by the w vanishes. And I see that now the stochastic process is R minus 1/2 sigma squared. The minus 1/2 sigma squared comes from Itô's lemma, dt plus sigma dw. So this is now the stochastic process for a new random variable y, which is the logarithm of S. And you see now this, the random variable y of capital T. So this guy here is y of capital T. So the random variable y of capital T, which is logarithm of S as T, has normal distribution with a certain given mean. So the mean is the initial value. Initial value is logarithm of S zero, plus the integral of this part here, which is our drift. This is the mean of this normal distributed random variable. And the standard deviation just is by integrating here the Brownian motion with this. Okay, so this is maybe related to the Itô isometry. So you know that then the variance is just the integral of sigma squared of t dt. So you can define here these two nice coefficients R bar, which is the average interest rate over time, and sigma bar squared, which is the average variance over time from the logarithm of the stock. And if you have these two parameters, you can write the distribution of our random variable logarithm of S of T. So actually it is a normal distributed random variable that has this mean. So that's the third step, or the next step. We now know the distribution of the underlying in this derivation of the analytic formula. And the last step is now to plug this in into the expectation and calculate the expectation analytically. So next step is the valuation. We plug this into the expectation operator under this measure. So this means I just plug in the definition of the function v, my payoff function. So that is maximum of s minus k, and the definition of the function b. So that is my numerator. So that was here the exponential rt, integral rt. I can move the exponential rt part in front of the expectation. This is a special case because the numerator is deterministic here. And you see that here inside you have the s. Well, I do not know the distribution of S. Well, I know it's log normal distribution distributed, but I know the distribution of the Y. It's normal distributed. So let's write the S as exponential of the logarithm of S, because then I know that this here is my known random variable Y of T, which is normal with a known mean and a known variance or standard deviation. So now I have to calculate this expectation. Expectation is an integral over the function multiplied with the density where we know the density of the normal distribution. Yeah, it's 1 divided by square root of 2p exponential minus 1/2 x squared. So I can write this as a nice integral here where I plug in the density of the standard normal distribution, so which you actually see here, and there is the payoff function maximum exponential y minus k. Okay, if you solve this integral, actually you will get this formula, and then we are done. So now we have the Black-Scholes formula. We get the distribution function, so the integral of the density. We have here the distribution function, the integral of the density, with certain values that depend on the parameter of our model. So the interest rate, the initial value, and the sigma parameter. Actually, all the guys here, R and sigma, averaged over time. So these parameters occur here in this distribution function. And we have this nice little formula. Let me quickly go through the slides where I solve this integral. So that is maybe something which you can look again at home. So how is this done? So to solve this integral, the first step is that you observe here this maximum function, maximum and zero, and you can replace it by just choosing the lower bound here, where this maximum function is switching from zero to something else. So then the maximum function is removed. Okay. Then the next step is that you have here exponential y, which is your s, minus k, and you split this into two different integrals, one with the constant, one with the exponential. And this second integral already looks quite nice. It's just an integral of the density with a certain bound. So with some substitution, you easily see that this will become the distribution function. So you see that you have something like k times distribution function at a certain point. For the other guy, you have here exponential of y and the density, but you can move the y inside and then take some quadratic addition, translation to also make this look like integrating the density at a different point. So here you find the corresponding substitution for this part that has the exponential inside. Okay, so if you use this substitution here for the part that has the exponential inside, then it also looks like a nice integral that is just integrating the density function, with a certain shift. There's a small shift in the mean and a constant in front. And the same for the other integral that has the k, which was already quite nice. And then you get these two nice integrals. Okay, so summary, you get this here as the solution. Okay, and then you can plug in back R and sigma here to solve this. You see that actually this is a very simple expression. And here you have the two distribution functions. And this guy here will have, since there is the logarithm of s zero inside here, so this guy here is actually has the s of zero inside. Okay, and we get the Black-Scholes formula. This averaged, so the root of the averaged variance here is called the Black-Scholes volatility. We will come back to this later. And maybe this is a good starting point for the next session. We can discuss the generalization of the Black-Scholes formula in the next session, because if you look back at the derivation that we did now, well, the derivation relied only on two simple aspects. And the two simple aspects is that we can define two objects. The first object is here our M, which is our numeraire in the previous derivation. And the second object is the S divided by M, which was our martingale. And then if you consider these two objects, you can rewrite the option as paying the maximum of F, which is our martingale, minus K and zero, multiplied with this M. Well, you see that M at capital T is equal to one. This is a very nice choice of the numeraire. You see, because I have here the capital T inside, right? So the M is not equal to the B, it's B divided by B of capital T. So that's my M here. So if you introduce these two objects, the Black-Scholes formula looks suddenly much nicer. So you have here the difference of F of zero, your martingale today, and the strike rate K, both multiplied with your numeraire observed in zero, M of zero, the numeraire that corresponds to the payment time. So this Black-Scholes formula here is the same. You can go back and compare it. And the proof that we have performed solely relied on the fact that F is a martingale under the measure that corresponds to choosing M as numeraire. And if we view Black-Scholes formula like this, you know, we will go back to the proof in the next session. We can very easily use it for interest rates models, because now M can be some other numeraire like a zero coupon bond, and F can be some other martingale like a forward rate, and so on. Yeah, so you see the link. That was it for today.